Signore e signori, buonasera e benvenuti alla virtuale Casa Italiana Zerilli Marimont. This evening we have the pleasure of continuing a long established tradition that is to have a discussion about cinema on the occasion of NICE New Italian Cinema Event in its 31st edition. It's easy for me to remember what edition it is because basically NICE and Casa Italiana were born the same year and from the very beginning started to collaborate on the endeavor of making Italian cinema more known in New York and the United States. And even if the main mission of NICE is to present new and upcoming directors, normally in their first or second film, this year we have this special section, very special section, that of course has to do also with the fact that NICE is based in Florence. And as many of you know, if you follow our events, this is the 700th anniversary of Dante Alighieri's death in Ravenna. So to celebrate this anniversary with our friends at NICE, we decided to make available streaming online. And if you have not streamed the films, you still have time and follow the instruction that you have received in our emails, two films about Dante, one from 1911 and the other one from 1921/24. The date of it is a bit problematic and I believe it's going to be part of our conversation. And to talk about these two films about Dante and to talk about Dante in cinema today, and I believe that that's a very the signature of NICE, to talk about classical cinema and to talk about contemporary cinema, we have the fortune to have with us Gianluca Farinelli, who is the director of the Cineteca of Bologna and one of the leading experts in classical cinema, and responsible as director of the Cineteca for the restoration of many of countless early films. And we're going to talk to him about the job of restoring films. What does it mean? What does it entail? We think to know, for example, how paintings and sculptures are restored. I believe none of us has any idea of how you restore films. And I take this opportunity to thank Gianluca Farinelli for the incredible work that the Cineteca does. And if many films are available today and we can still see them, it's thanks to them. Not only, but through the festival that they organize in Bologna every summer, Il Cinema Ritrovato, it's also a channel, a conduit to make these films available in America. My friends, for example, of the Criterion Collection are there every summer, and every time they come back, they bring back to the US some precious film that had been lost and that had been restored and brought back to life, and they distribute it in the US. So the fundamental work that Gianluca does, so we're going to talk about his job, the mission of the Cineteca, and specifically about these two films. Connected to Gianluca, we are going to have Peter Lukasz, who is a professor here at the Tisch School of the Arts at New York University. His early interests were in photography, now, of course, in cinematography. Peter is working on an ongoing ambitious project of bringing into film the trilogy, the three canticas of the Divine Comedy. We had a very successful event at Casa Italiana, hosted by my colleague Alison Cornish last week, in which Peter had a chance to present his film on Purgatorio to an audience of students that were very enthusiastic and very curious with a lot of questions for him. And as I mentioned, Professor Alison Cornish, chair of the Department of Italian Studies at New York University, a leading scholar of Dante, and right now also the president of the Dante Society of America, the most prestigious institution that gathers all the scholars of Dante in the US. And we also have as interpreter Maria Galetta, very familiar face and voice for the public of Casa Italiana. She's going to help us out with the translation as needed. And since we have a lot of people, a lot of interesting people, and we're talking about two great films, I would like to start with Gianluca Farinelli. And before that, otherwise Julian is going to kick me virtually, obviously, I remind all of you that you can submit questions and comments clicking on the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. So at any moment, feel free to have questions, especially Professor Farinelli, at a certain point, we'll have to go. We are very thankful because he's in Bologna right now, where it's 11 p.m. So we would like to take care of business with him in the first part of our webinar and then let him go home before midnight. Thank you, Gianluca. Grazie mille, Gianluca, per essere qua con noi, per aver accettato il nostro invito.
Grazie, allora, grazie Stefano, grazie anche per quello che hai detto.
Raccontaci un po', come decidete quali sono i film da salvare, i film da restaurare? Ce ne sono tanti. Quali sono i criteri che portano al salvataggio di alcuni film e altri no, ad esempio?
How do you decide how to pick the movies that you restore, that you save in your activity?
Ci sono vari criteri che devono necessariamente convivere per prendere una decisione. Il primo criterio è lo stato dei materiali. Ecco, quando il supporto di un film rischia di decadere, quindi di portare alla scomparsa di quel film, di cui probabilmente non esistono altre copie, quindi lo stato dei materiali e la rarità dei materiali sono due criteri molto importanti.
Well, there are many different criteria that we need to consider. The first one is the state in which the media is. If the support is in such a state that it would disappear and we would have no more copies left, then that takes priority.
Poi c'è un interesse storico del materiale, un interesse estetico. Ma qui, ecco, questo tipo di criteri dipendono anche molto dall'istituzione che promuove il restauro. Ecco, per esempio, per noi Cinema di Bologna, è molto importante il cinema muto italiano e negli ultimi 30 anni abbiamo lavorato perché questo periodo, che era 30 anni fa molto oscuro, uscisse dall'ombra e i film potessero essere visti da un pubblico contemporaneo.
And then a second criteria is how important historically and aesthetically the movie is. It depends on the institute that deals with them. Of course, this is a choice that depends on the agency that deals with it. For us, for instance, Italian silent movies are very important. And for instance, 30 years ago, there were many movies that were not known at all, and we worked on them.
Quando io ho cominciato a occuparmi di storia del cinema, quindi all'inizio degli anni Ottanta, le storie del cinema italiano fondamentalmente dicevano che il cinema italiano nasceva con il neorealismo, eventualmente con il cinema dei telefoni bianchi, e poi c'era qualche piccolo paragrafo sul cinema muto con una cosa molto lontana e molto poco importante. Ecco, nel corso del tempo, anche grazie al lavoro di grandi storici come Bernardini, come Martinelli, come Giampiero Brunetta, il cinema muto è uscito dall'ombra e abbiamo scoperto che in realtà il cinema muto italiano era stato importantissimo non solo per il cinema europeo, ma per la storia del cinema mondiale, che il Colossal era nato in Italia, che i diva film, le star al femminile erano nate in Italia e che il cinema italiano era ricco di capolavori anche negli anni 0, negli anni 10, negli anni 20.
When I started to deal with this in the 80s, the histories of Italian cinema said that Italian cinema started with neorealism, maybe with the telefoni bianchi, the white phone, so-called white phone cinema. Nobody spoke about the Italian silent movies, and it was thanks to some scholars such as Bernardini, Martinelli, and Brunetta, that all of this came into the understanding of the general public, and people finally understood how important Italian silent movies were, not only for the history of European movies, but also for the history of movies for the entire world. And it was in Italy that the star system was born, and it was in Italy that the first colossal movie was created. So Italian silent movies were important in not only in 1900 but in 1910, 1920 and so on.
Poi la Cineteca di Bologna non è una cineteca di Stato, è una fondazione, E quindi il nostro interesse non è solo verso il cinema italiano, ma è più in generale verso la storia del cinema. E per esempio abbiamo, ci siamo occupati negli ultimi 30 anni anche del restauro dell'opera di Chaplin o dell'opera di Buster Keaton, cioè di autori che certamente non sono italiani, ma che sono parte essenziale della storia del cinema e della storia dell'umanità.
Certo,
Cineteca in Bologna is not a state-owned institute. It is a foundation, a private foundation, and therefore our interest is in the history of the cinema in general, not in Italian cinema specifically. So we also work on artists that are not Italian, such as Buster Keaton, for instance.
Gianluca. And quello che, what maybe the question I can ask in English. I was struck, and I'm always very surprised when at the beginning of the films that the Cineteca restored, there is the slide in which you say where the copies on which the Cineteca worked were found. And there are always surprises. And especially for Italian films, maybe one copy, maybe a mutilated copy was found somewhere. And then the copies on which that really allowed for the rebuilding of the original version are found in cinetechs all over the world. And just to quote the examples that we saw in the films, like Hungary, former Yugoslavia, Denmark, Spain. How come these films are scattered in these other places? And how do you find out about them? And what was the most surprising discovery that you made in this field?
Sì, guarda, Stefano, questa è una bellissima domanda perché spiega anche il ruolo degli archivi. Cioè oggi è disponibile sul web, sulle piattaforme, la storia del cinema. Ecco, quando noi eravamo giovani non era certamente così. Ma perché oggi questi film della storia del cinema sono disponibili? Perché gli archivi, le cineteche esistono dagli anni 30 e hanno conservato quel patrimonio che altrimenti sarebbe andato perduto. E la cosa straordinaria è che la cultura non ha confini, la cultura è internazionale e quindi il cinema, che è un'arte internazionale, l'invenzione dei Lumieri immediatamente è stata portata in tutto il mondo ed immediatamente è stata copiata in tutto il mondo, fa sì che da sempre si vedono in tutto il mondo film prodotti nei luoghi più lontani. Il cinema italiano è stato fin dai primi anni 10 un cinema molto internazionale, un cinema che è stato visto dappertutto nel mondo e quindi fortunatamente si trovano copie di film italiani dappertutto, anche dei film italiani del cinema muto. E addirittura per la maggior parte che i film italiani del muto noi non li abbiamo trovati in Italia, ma li abbiamo trovati nel mondo. Ecco, il caso dell'Inferno è clamoroso, perché abbiamo trovato 14 copie fuori dall'Italia e addirittura le copie più complete erano la copia bulgara, la copia inglese e la copia danese. Ma forse la cosa più buffa che mi sia mai successa è quando abbiamo restaurato Macista e l'Inferno, che è un film molto divertente della metà degli anni 20, che combina Dante con la cultura pop e quindi con Maciste, con un forzuto, e abbiamo trovato metafilm, cioè tutte le versioni diciamo sexy in Brasile, e l'altra metà, tutta la parte più dantesca e meno scollacciata, l'abbiamo trovata in Danimarca, e mettendo assieme le due copie abbiamo fatto la versione completa.
I love this question, Stefano, because it gives me an opportunity to talk about the role of the archive. Nowadays, we can find the entire history of cinema on the web, and this is thanks to the activity of all the cinetechs all over the world, because cinema is a truly international art. It's an art that has no border. in the Italian silent cinema was actually produced all over. It was a very international type of cinema. And that is why we found copies of Italian silent movies all over the world, and we didn't find them in Italy. In fact, for the Inferno movie, we found 14 copies everywhere in the world but in Italy. The most important copies were in Bulgaria, in England, and in Denmark. And for instance, there was another movie, Maciste all'Inferno, that combines Dante and pop culture, you know, the strong arm of Maciste. And we found the half of the movie that had more sexy scenes in Brazil, and the other half that was more Dantesque in Denmark. So we were able to put the two together and actually recreate the entire movie.
I love how Denmark and Brazil divided equally or almost, thing. And if I remember correctly, Maciste all'Inferno is one of the films that Federico Fellini remembers seeing as a young boy in his father's arms in the movie theater in Rimini.
Esatto,
addirittura the genealogy of these,
Federico diceva: e per tutta la vita io non ho fatto altro che rifare il primo film che ho visto.
Yes, in fact, Fellini said that for my entire life I did nothing but recreate the first movie that I saw.
That was Maciste all'Inferno. So with the Dantesque element returning. And I'm going to ask you our last question for the day. And if our viewers or our members of the panel have questions or comments on what you just said, I invite them to ask. So let's talk. Tell us something about these two films about Dante, brought back to life and restored on the occasion of the anniversary. What can you tell us about them, aside from this very fascinating genealogy that you reconstruct for them?
Sì, sono due film straordinari. L'Inferno del 1911 è un film che richiese quasi 3 anni di produzione. È un film straordinario per molti aspetti, intanto per la durata, perché è un film che supera l'ora e che ha richiesto uno sforzo produttivo enorme, tant'è che il film comincia con la produzione Saffi e poi viene creata invece una nuova casa di produzione, la Milano Film, che è sostenuta da Giovanni Visconti di Modrone, che è il fratello di Giuseppe Visconti, che è il padre di Luchino Visconti, e che era la guida indiscussa della Scala dell'inizio del Novecento, del teatro La Scala di Milano. Ed è un film straordinario per l'uso degli esterni, per le scenografie interne, perché è completamente ispirato alle immagini di Dorè, che lungo tutto l'Ottocento e nell'inizio del Novecento avevano dato veramente l'immagine di Dante nelle pubblicazioni. Ed è anche il primo film ad aver vinto un festival. Nel 1909 fu organizzato il primo festival internazionale a Milano, dove fu mostrato l'inizio del film, a cui fu dato il premio come miglior film. E inoltre è uno dei primi lungometraggi della storia del cinema, ed è anche un film che fu lanciato con straordinaria forza. Fu presentato in Italia nei grandi teatri, ma questo avvenne anche fuori dall'Italia ed ebbe anche un vero lancio, una vera preparazione, oggi si direbbe di marketing, cosa che per il 1911 era assolutamente inusuale. E c'è anche un utilizzo degli effetti speciali davvero, davvero molto, davvero molto importante. E questo è L'Inferno del 1911 è davvero un film che resta nella storia del cinema, e il suo restauro è stato anche un restauro molto complesso. In particolare abbiamo molto lavorato anche sulle didascalie, perché lo vedrete, le didascalie hanno una doppia lingua, cioè in parte citano i versi di Dante e in parte invece raccontano una storia per un pubblico che magari Dante non lo conosce.
It is really extraordinary. Inferno from 1911, it's really an extraordinary movie. It took years just to produce it, and it's over 1 hour long. So it took two different production companies, and the second one was headed by Giovanni Visconti di Modrone, who is the father of Luchino Visconti, and at that point he was actually the most important guy at La Scala Theater in Milan. The interiors are also amazing. They are basically based on the Doré tables that in the 1900s, at the beginning of the 1900s, basically set the scene for the idea that everybody had of Dante. And this movie was also the first winner of the first international festival that was created, organized in Milan. It is one of the first ever feature films in the world, and it was presented in large theaters both in Italy and abroad, and it was also presented with a marketing campaign that was totally unusual for the times. There were lots of special effects. In short, it's a pillar of the history of cinema. And the subtitles are also very important because they show both Dante verses and also the story of the movie.
Gianluca, for the sake of brevity, we say that it's a black and white film. But this film is everything but black and white. There are very powerful colors underlining the different scenes. As we mentioned, there are lots of special effects. It's like a feast of the eye with the special effects, people flying, people dreaming, and you see the images of their dreams. And I was very interested also in the soundtrack, that I know it's not, of course, restored, but it's something that has been added. And I was wondering what was your role or the role of the Cineteca in that soundtrack that is very interesting because it combines what we could define experimental music or contemporary music with distorted sound, a distorted voice, in which you can recognize parts of the original Dante text, and then sound effects. Like I love, for example, the idea that when we are in limbo and Dante and Virgil are surrounded by the other poet, the music is basically the rhythm of the typewriter, of an old typewriter with the ding at the end of the line. So like these people wrote, and therefore there is this sound. As I was just curious about if you can tell us something about the choice of the soundtrack.
Sì, guarda, sui colori, il cinema muto, tutti pensiamo appunto che fosse silenzioso, in realtà il cinema muto era rumorosissimo, perché una sala aveva come minimo un piano, ma spesso aveva delle vere e proprie orchestre, dei rumoristi, un bonimanter, quindi era tutto meno che silenzioso, e non era fatto in bianco e nero, nel senso che la pellicola era in bianco e nero, ma poi veniva colorata con varie tecniche, poteva essere colorata a mano, fotogramma per fotogramma, oppure utilizzando l'imbibizione o il viraggio. E questo film utilizza l'imbibizione e il viraggio in maniera molto spettacolare, che si combinano anche con un'atmosfera molto notturna, perché è l'idea del Dante di Doré, quindi molto notturno, molto onirico. E per questo abbiamo chiesto a un gruppo di musica elettronica, secondo me straordinario, che sono gli Edison Studio, che sono tra l'altro di Ravenna, dove è morto Dante, ma questo è del tutto casuale, che hanno fatto questa partitura molto moderna, molto onirica, che credo ridia questo senso sperimentale del film. Ecco, nel 1911 non c'era una lingua standardizzata del cinema, e quindi i pionieri andavano in molte direzioni diverse. Il cinema delle origini, che era fatto tutto di effetti speciali, era non tanto lontano. Il cinema in Italia nasce nel 1905, quindi il cinema aveva appena 6 anni quando il film esce, e questa dimensione sperimentale che fa sì che questo film sia contemporaneamente molto antico e molto moderno, secondo me questa musica che tu hai raccontato benissimo riesce a sorprenderci e a ridare questa dimensione di modernità al film.
Grazie mille, Gianluca. Maria.
Well, yes, exactly. There were colors in this movie because oftentimes the film would be colored by hand or using different techniques such as toning. And a silent movie was not silent at all, was very noisy, in fact, because in the cinemas there was at least a piano, but sometimes an orchestra, effects, all kinds of things. And so what we decided to do is we asked a group of electronic music to create a soundtrack for this movie, and they did so, and it's really amazing because it gives it back this dreamy sense. You need to consider that in 1911 the movie was not yet standardized. There were different pioneers that were going in different directions, and the cinema in Italy was born in 1905, so in 1911 was only 6 years old. And you were really amazing in giving the idea of the soundtrack of this movie. You couldn't have done it better, Stefano.
And Gianluca, ti voglio lasciare andare. There is a question from the audience that asks about the Pordenone Festival. There is also a festival dedicated to silent cinema. What is the role that this festival has in bringing to light not only Italian films, but also world cinema belonging to the first generation of filmmakers? And our viewer is also asking what other important such festivals are held in Italy?
Pordenone è stato un festival importante, è un festival importantissimo, in particolare nei primi anni della sua storia è stato un festival assolutamente rivoluzionario, ecco perché negli anni Ottanta il cinema muto era ancora un grande sconosciuto, e il festival di Pordenone ha avuto il merito di mostrare i film e riunire una comunità internazionale che ha scoperto di essere molto meno, dove tutti hanno scoperto di essere molto meno solitari e quindi ha dato avvio a grandi progetti di collaborazione tra studiosi, tra università, tra cineteche, tra istituzioni, e ha veramente aperto una strada. Ecco, io stesso, senza il Festival di Pordenone probabilmente non avrei mai capito l'enormità e l'importanza del cinema muto. In Italia esiste dal 1986 il Cinema Ritrovato, che è un festival che si svolge a Bologna alla fine di giugno e che ha sempre varie sezioni dedicate al cinema muto, uno in particolare di cui siamo molto fieri che è una sezione dedicata al cinema di 100 anni fa, che quindi anno per anno ci fa scoprire la stagione cinematografica. Quest'anno è stato il 1921, l'anno prossimo sarà il 1922.
Yes, the Pordenone Movie Festival is extremely important. As I told you before, in the 80s, nobody knew anything about the silent movies. And this festival really had deserves the credit for gathering the entire international community around the silent movie and creating a lot of cooperative projects between schools and scholars, universities, cinematheques, and so on. It basically opened roads for silent movie. And even myself, I would not have been so interested and so knowledgeable in silent movies without the Pordenone Festival. Then in 1986, the Cinema Ritrovato festival started in Bologna, and it's every year at the end of June. And so every year we present the movies of 100 years before. And we're very proud of that. And this coming year, we will show movies from 1922.
That's only one section, Maria. They present all sorts of silent films. And then there is a section within the festival in okay. which they do just the films of 100 years before. And Gianluca, thank you so much. So we'll see you in Bologna for Il Cinema Ritrovato, or we'll bring you physically to Casa Italiana as soon as it's possible to talk more with you about the extraordinary work that the Cineteca di Bologna does to bring back to life cinema that we need very much. Grazie, grazie. Mille ancora.
Grazie Stefano, grazie. Grazie a Maria. A presto.
And now Peter. So we talked with Gianluca about the first, one of the first feature-length film, definitely the first film about Dante. And you have probably responsible for the last wave, the newest wave of films about Dante. So we presented your film on Purgatorio last week at the Casa for an audience of students and faculties. Many of them were students of Alison, and some of them were your students, some of them were my students. So the first question is, what possessed you to make a film about Dante, to embark in such an enterprise? It's a scary thought, because after these early films, 1911, 1921, it seemed that for a while people were kind of afraid of bringing Dante on cinema. Tell us what animated you, what inspired you to start your very ambitious project on the three cantica.
Well, thank you so much for the invitation. Can you hear me fine?
Yes, very well.
Thank you so much for the invitation. As I mentioned to Alison last week during the Q&A, I went about this completely, perhaps in the wrong way. I've been reading Purgatorio for 25 years, just constantly reading it and rereading it. And I never read Paradiso until last year, and I never read The Inferno until last year as well. So I kind of went about this in the wrong way. But I'm a big believer in that you have to have a winter project in New York, because New York has, winter is hard in New York, and you need something to get you outside. And when the weather turns really bad, you have something to do and you're in sync with the season. So about 4 or 5 years ago, we had an early snowfall in November. And I thought to myself, oh, what's going to be my winter project? And I grabbed the camera and I ran to the Staten Island Ferry and filmed the first snowfall of the year. And the gods of the Staten Island Ferry were shining on me that day, because I didn't know it at the time. But there are 10 boats that make the trip between Manhattan and Staten Island. Some of them hop up and down. You cannot film. Some of them glide horizontally across the bay, and you can film. And on that first day in the snow, I was lucky enough to get on 2 boats that went horizontally. And I was really shocked at the footage. Not only was it very beautiful in the weather, but I thought everyone looked like refugees and migrants. And it immediately made me turn to Purgatorio again, because this, you're on this boat going back and forth between these places in the middle of these tempests, in the middle of these storms. And it took me 4 winters to successfully get the footage that I wanted for the film. And over those 4 winters, I very carefully started to do a very close reading and select the cantos that I wanted to read while the people were going back and forth. And as I mentioned to Alison last week, I didn't really move into the mountain, to the terraces, to the circle, those kind of circles. I stayed more in the anti-purgatory and the crossing of the waters and everyone waiting to enter the gates to purgatory itself. And so I originally wanted to have, I wanted to celebrate the diversity of New York. I wanted to have different voices reading the different cantos. And I had everyone lined up, and then COVID hit. Just as we finished filming, so I ended up reading the cantos myself. And as COVID settled in, I decided that maybe I'll do all three books. And I looked, and I'm in the middle of another big film project in Brazil. And I looked at my hard drives from many years of filming in Brazil. And I had enough footage of the gardens in Rio to do a rough cut for Paradiso. So I have an 80-minute rough cut of that. And I'm shooting the Inferno right now in Brooklyn, in the kind of dark corners of Brooklyn at dusk. And so that's how it all started. And in the middle film on Purgatorio called Before the Close of Day is already playing in film festivals right now.
You gotta love that Purgatorio is the Staten Island Ferry. Paradise is gardens in Brazil, and hell is Brooklyn. I don't know how popular that's going to be with Brooklynites, but according to some people, Inferno is the most interesting place of all. Professor Cornish, we heard from our colleague Peter Lukas that he started with Purgatorio. What would be your suggestion to somebody that wants to start a reading of The Committee? I know you're a big fan of Purgatorio too, but normally what happens is that Inferno is a big hit, right? It's most interesting. There are the larger-than-life figures. But what would be your suggestion? Did Peter do the right thing? Would you suggest anybody to start with Purgatorio? Should one start with the reading of The Commedia?
No, it's an odd choice. I mean, it is a journey, and it has linearity. It has a beginning, and it has an end. I often say that, you know, one of the classical things is that you start in the middle, in medias res. And of course, the Inferno starts in the middle of life's journey. But yes, the journey does go on. I mean, I think the way that Peter approached his film, and maybe the way he approached Dante is, I mean, I think your film is very lyrical. And I think when you were talking to our students, you talked about your theory of filmmaking is to work in beads. I think that's what you called it. And beads on a necklace, which is a way of thinking about lyric poetry and putting little pieces. We often think about Petrarch's canzoniere as kind of beads on a necklace that has a narrative arc, but it's done lyrically. And the reason why I think, I mean, in many ways I was sort of joking with Peter that there's no mountain and there's no bad weather in Purgatory. And so the bad weather and the fact that we're on the horizontal all the time seem to be contrary to Purgatory. But the things that really are like Purgatory is this meditation on time. And the lyric is the lyric moment, right? And that every time you go back and forth on the ferry, it's the same and it's different every single time. And of course, people in Dante's Purgatory are going around and around that mountain, but it's not endless. It's actually time that is useful, time that is actually taking people somewhere. And so that notion of travel and being on the way, I mean, he mentioned refugees and migrants, the term that Dante would use would be pilgrim. That the journey and the time is seems monotonous and has that lyrical appreciation of the moment, and yet it is actually going somewhere. And I was thinking also Peter explained that the title of the movie is Before the Close of the Day, which he's taking from a liturgical hymn, Te Lucis Ante Terminum, and it's like all liturgical hymns is associated with a time of the day. So it's a way of marking time. Has to do with, you know, with appreciating using time before it's gone, right? Before the day is gone, what can we kind of get done spiritually? So those are some thoughts that I had about Peter's film. It's also it's very gray, but it's also kind of hopeful because people are looking out of the window, and the window is all kind of got weather on it. So there's this play of surface and distance of one's and the reflection of oneself, and then the distant. You have a whole sequence on the Statue of Liberty, and of course, Purgatory is about liberty, as we know from Virgil telling Cato, the guardian, that this man is seeking liberty. So the whole
libertava cercando che si
cara. Exactly. So that was super, super, super cool. It was definitely very much like Purgatorio. And so you have people, and examining these people is the way they walk, and they're sort of like an ocean of sameness and individuality at the same time as they move. And I thought that was very Dantesque. But the only kind of vertical part of it, I think I talked about this before, apart from the Statue of Liberty, are these seagulls that, you know, are gray, kind of dirty urban birds, but they give this element of flight to the whole thing. Anyway, so those are some thoughts that I had about Peter's film. And it's so different from the 1911 Dante's Inferno, which is, you know, so spectacular for the time, right? The special effects that are just so amazing, people floating around. But there is something about seeing that at a distance and being not a film person and sort of finding that kind of comical, right? I mean, there's something about our sophistication with, you know, special effects now that's aged in a way, right? That makes it seem very particular from a particular time and a particular technological moment. And the other thing I was thinking about is Dante thinks about art all the time. And especially in the Purgatorio, you know, the Terrace of Pride, there are those bas-reliefs, and there's a whole meditation on what static images can do, mute images can do, as opposed to what poetry can do. And then if you had a static image, but you could make it move, so he's already sort of imagining cinema, moving pictures, and then could you make those static images both move and speak? But there's a whole meditation on looking at art and how we need art to see, and that we see through images, and that's the area of art. Sorry, I'm giving a Dante lecture, but those are some things that I was thinking about.
Well, that's what we expect of you when we invite you to something.
I do when you push my button. Yeah.
And Peter, I want to go back to you and your own reaction to these films, especially to the 1911 film. Had you seen this film before you started your project? Have you seen it after? Has it inspired you in any way or not? When you saw it, did you say, I just want to do something completely different from this? Tell me, what was your reaction as a filmmaker to the Dante films?
Before I do that, I want to add one last thing to Allison's comments. Another thing I was thinking of with the film on Purgatory, and with all three films, and including the 1911 film, is this idea of film as prayer. Mm. And what I mean by prayer is more of an ecumenical sense, where the kind of prayer I'm thinking of when I make films, because I've experimented with film as prayer before in some short films. And what I'm thinking of is the kind of shrines in Afghanistan, Tibet, Nepal, where people take a piece of their clothing, they tie it to the shrine as a prayer, and that prayer can only be received when it's in motion. So this idea of prayer in motion. And so when in filming Purgatorio on the boat, everything's in constant motion. It's prayer in motion. It's prayers that are received. And in that way, everyone on the boat had a lot of hope, because everyone has hope in Purgatorio. Everyone is going to be transformed, and everyone is going to go to Paradiso. And so that's why the idea of prayer in the film is constantly in motion.
Yeah, yeah. And that's what liturgical hymns are. They're prayer in motion. So that's.
And as far as the 1911 film goes, I've known about this film for maybe 5-6 years or so. And it's incredible. And before I went out to shoot the Inferno part of this, I did study this film. Maybe a couple years ago, there's a YouTube version of the film, and I studied it. For example, there's a scene in the film at about 40 minutes. It's tilted, it's tinted purple. And people have been transformed into old gnarled trees, and the harpies descend on the trees, and they're picking at the trees to inflict pain on the people that are trapped inside the trees, and naked, condemned scared. People were moving through the woods, and Dante and Virgil are standing there, and then the black mastiffs come chasing them through the woods. Oh my God, that scene is incredible. That scene is incredible. When I watched that scene over and over again, I thought to myself, ah, that's what I need to film. I need to go into the woods of Brooklyn and film dead trees in the middle of winter. And it worked. And so it's a small example of how the 1911 film influenced my new film that I'm shooting in all kinds of ways. But when I see that clip, I see the whole history of silent film there, the magic, the special effects. I see the Lumiere brothers in that film. The whole magic of silent cinema is not just in this film, but especially in that clip at 40 minutes.
Sorry, Peter, you mentioned the fact that it reminds you of the Lumiere brothers, so the very origins of cinema, and where this element of magic was so present. I mean, it is that you could make happen things on film that would not happen in reality. So that aspect was very pervasive in early cinema, the idea of making possible the impossible. So the special effects are very much in this way, like they show you things that normally in reality you would not be able to see. Peter, is there anything else you want to add about the cinema of the origins and magic and how Dante helped to create this relationship with cinema and magic?
Well, I think that at the base of the 1911 film, it's a very fixed camera angle. It's very much like a Lumiere 1 minute. There are 54 scenes in the film. Each one is around a minute. Each one is kind of like a Lumiere shot. People move, but the frame is fixed. But there's this layering of special effects, superimpositions, magic tricks. People come flying on ropes. Sometimes you see the rope, sometimes you don't. You have multiple exposures, multiple layers. You have this very static frame and this very deep layering of special effects. It's just magical. It's the sheer magic of silent cinema. I watched this film and it made me go back and rewatch my favorite silent films. For example, Alice in Wonderland in 1903. This has to be the most magical silent film ever made. And the sheer magic of this time is in the 1911 Inferno film. It's incredible.
Wonderful. And I just want to say a couple of things about the 1921/24 film. That is a very different film. It's a biography of Dante somehow, commissioned for the 6th century anniversary from Dante's death. The consulting team that worked on this film was headed by Isidoro del Lungo, that was considered at that time probably the most prominent Dante. He was the equivalent of Alison Cornish 100 years ago. And it's biographical, and it includes some factual, historically accurate elements, and it includes also stories that never happened in the life of Dante. And the interesting thing of this film is that it had two releases. When it was, first of all, they wanted to release it in 1921. It didn't happen because they were late. So it was pushed to 1922, came out, was not really a big success. Actually, it was a flop. And then in the mid-20s, when the fascist regime was already established, and when it decided that Dante had to be considered and revered as a founding father of the idea of Italy that fascism proposed, they had a re-release. Basically, they reissued the film and they orchestrate a campaign, a massive campaign that included historians, literary critics, film critic, popular tabloids, newspapers. And the film is released again. And this time it becomes a success. It's one of these very interesting manipulations of history and the way in which we also understand on how many levels fascism interacted with cinema. So it was not only promoting and giving money to projects that were in tune with the fascist ideology or censoring films that were not in tune with it. But it's also, I found that this operation of the re-release or relaunching of a film that was a flop at first and then becomes a great success is also another very interesting element, nuance of the way in which fascism dealt with cinema. Alison, the question I wanted to ask is that after you saw these films, what do you think we can do as educators, as people to teach Dante with these films? How can we incorporate it? Are they useful to teach? What is the kind of interaction that you would expect your students who are studying the text with you of Dante, what benefit they can have or not from watching these films?
Well, the NYU students are really into this sort of thing, and they're very subtle readers of film, I would say. And so I have some people working, well, one of a student we share, I believe, Peter and I, and he made a film recently that was successful. They definitely are able to read that reception of Dante probably better than I can. And so, you know, we now all have access to filmmaking, you know, so for example, the Canto per Canto project that I did, you know, I had, you know, total neophytes just talking to each other on film. And so we have sort of entered a new phase of engaging in a video environment, not just with Dante, representing Dante, but talking about Dante and showing pictures and, you know, and so forth. So yeah, I think there's lots of receptions of Dante in every century. And now the 1911 Dante has become a classic. I mean, I'm so interested listening to Gianluca Farinelli talk about, you know, the sort of Italian philological spirit of the archives and going out to find the manuscripts, as we would say in my field, but going out to find those fragments and witnesses of something and then reconstructing it. So yes, I think it adds to receptions of the poet at different times, which now we can look back upon in our history of cinema.
Thank you, Alison. I think we have a few minutes if anybody in the audience has a question or a comment for our panelists. I'm delighted that we had more than 50 people following us beginning to end, and I thank them for their attention. And if there is any question you might have, otherwise, while we wait, I just want to remind you that that this event was part of Nietzsche New Italian Cinema events in New York, that you can see a lot of films, new and old, by following the instructions that we sent via email or that you can find on our website, casaitalianany.org. And our next webinar in connection with NICE New Italian event is going to be about a completely different topic, still Florentine though. We're going to talk about El Numero Nueve, that is a documentary on Batistuta that was one of the most legendary soccer players that the Fiorentina, that is the soccer team from Florence, has ever had, Batigol. And we're going to have a panel discussion about this documentary with the director, Pablo Benedetti, of the film. It's going to be moderated by my colleague, Julian Sachs, who happens to be a great fan of Fiorentina, aside from being the person that makes technologically possible all the things that we do. And Andrea Fiano, a very important journalist here in New York. So this is going to happen tomorrow, November 18th at 5 p.m., same channel, same place.
I was wondering if you were going to see a little bit of trailer from, I don't know, the Inferno or the Purgatorio I just saw, but of Peter Lucas.
Peter, that would be a great way for us to close these events. Why don't you show us one of the trailers for your films? And this is sort of I want our viewers to leave this webinar with the images that you created in their eyes. And I thank again Alison Cornish, Chair of the Department of Italian Studies at NYU and President of the Dante Society of America, and Peter Lukasz, professor at the Tisch School of the Arts, photographer and cinematographer. Thank you very much to both of you. And I think we should close with a trailer from Peter Film. Thank you.
So let's close with this trailer from the Purgatorio film. This website, the danteproject.net, has trailers for all three films. We're in production with Inferno. We're in post-production with Paradiso. And the middle film before the close of day is finished and it's playing. And let me play the trailer from the Purgatorio film. Can everyone see it?
Yes, we can see perfectly.
Just as travelers, absorbed in thought, when they overtake strangers on the road, turn to them without stopping. So coming behind us with more speed and passing on, crowd of souls, silent and devout, gazed at us with wonder.